487. Once so aimlessly I wandered round the tangled paths of sin. All about me seemed so hopeless, doubts and fears without within. Then a voice so kind and gentle spoke sweet peace unto my soul. Gone my days of sin and wandering since the Savior took me whole. I have never lost the wonder of it all. I have never lost the wonder of it all. Since the day that Jesus saved me and a whole new life he gave me, I have never lost the wonder of it all. Now my life is full of gladness, all my days are filled with joy. I no longer walk in sadness, happy songs my lips employ. For I've learned the wondrous secret, only those in Christ can know. 'Tis the peace of sins forgiven, joy that makes me glad hope. I have never lost the wonder of it all. I have never lost the wonder of it all. Since the day that Jesus saved me and a whole new life he gave me, I have never lost the wonder of it all.
All right, thank you, Brother Lee. You can be seated. Anybody need a prayer sheet tonight? Hold your hand up. Yeah, Brother Jimmy needs one back there, Brother Galen. And I've never lost the wonder of it all. Amen. What a blessing. My dad used to say, don't ever get over getting saved. Amen. Don't ever get over getting saved. And it's raining outside. And praise the Lord. I had a joke I could tell you, but Brother Joe told me to mark that one off the list. So I'm going to forego that joke. And I've got another really bad joke, too. It's really more of a jail joke. And so I don't think it's not a Sunday morning joke, I know that, but I'm not sure it's a Wednesday night joke either. So we're going to practice on that joke a little bit more. But anyway, it was really funny. So let me give you some prayer requests here. And we have the prayer sheets there. And okay, Chris and Jenny Moffitt want to remember to pray for them. And they were involved in a real bad car wreck, and both of them had to have surgeries. And I know Chris broke both legs, and Miss Jenny had to be, intubated, or however you say it, you know, and just a lot going on with all of that, lung collapsed and so forth. So please pray for them. Miss Cindy kind of took off and went to Memphis to be with them. And anyway, so they'll probably have a pretty long recovery, I would say. They're both stable now, and that's a blessing, so we thank the Lord for that. But you pray for them. Miss Renee Stith, the Stith, Brother Travis and Miss Renee drive over from Hampton, and her sister-in-law's 1-month-old, a nephew, had heart surgery this morning at Children's Hospital, had a hole in his heart, and his name's Cohen. And they were there's a lot involved with all of that, but this afternoon they were really starting to kind of get him back, you know, to where he needed to be with warming his body and all a bunch of different things they do. So please pray for little Cohen that God will be with him. And then, of course, we got Miss Peggy Smith will be having surgery on Monday. I ask you to pray for her. Miss Vera Brumley had fallen, and Miss Vera broke her wrist and also broke a vertebrae in her back. So she broke her back as well. And so please pray for Miss Vera. And Miss Debbie got by to see her last night. Brother Tucker got by to see her today. And she's, you know, kind of sedated and all today. And I'm sure they're trying to keep her comfortable. But and then Miss Velma Smith, Miss Peggy's sister, is under hospice care. So we want to pray for Miss Velma. And of course, you know, all of them, Miss Vera's in her 90s and Miss Velma's in her 90s, you know. And so they're just getting up there. And of course, Miss Peggy and all of that. And then also pray for Miss Patsy Lee. Miss Patsy's Miss Lisa Owen's mother, Mamma, we called her. And she just had a hard time tolerating her chemo. And it just made her sick. And, you know, and frail and weak and all of that. And you know how sometimes that can just really take a toll on people, and that's kind of what's happening to Miss Patsy. And so pray for her. And then also Miss Lisa was gone this weekend back to Atlanta for her treatments as well. And pray for Miss Carol Bridges. Miss Carol had fallen recently also and broke her foot and been in the hospital. And then now she's in the nursing home, and she also has COVID on top of that. So please pray for Miss Carol. We appreciate that. And then my Uncle George Wido, he had back surgery, and he's recovering from that, and he's doing kind of the rehab part there on that now. And then my little granddaughter, Olivia, is sick. We ask you to pray for Olivia. And, of course, continue to pray for Miss Ellen Griffin. We've been praying for her. And then I have some friends of mine that are singers, and they're from Washington County Baptist Church in Lincoln, Arkansas. And I haven't got to have them in yet. It's a family, and it's the Smith family. And they have maybe three girls and a little boy. And the girls are, you know, teenagers, and maybe the oldest one might be like 19 or 20. But the mom and dad sing, and the whole family sings and plays instruments, and they're a blessing. And we're going to get them in here. But anyway, Brother Smith had to have surgery yesterday, and he's in a lot of pain, and back, vertebrae, you know, neck and all this stuff. So he's got a lot going on with that, and it could even affect his vocal cords. And so he's real, you know, if he hadn't had the surgery, it would have affected him. So anyway, just pray for him moving forward. They're going to be off the road for maybe a couple of months, maybe, you know, 2 to 3 months maybe. So anyway, you pray for them, and we'll probably try to do something, send them a love offering through our missions program to be a help and a blessing. But well, I'll tell you one thing about when you go through surgeries, you're really a lot more sensitive to people who might be hurting when you've hurt, you know, and it just kind of reminds you that, hey, you know, it's not, I mean, it's a big deal when people are going into surgeries, and they really, really do need our prayers, okay? And I've tried to go back, and there's lots and lots and lots of people that prayed for me, and I've tried to go back and just text them and thank them and thank them and thank them, and you know, and I'm getting all kinds of texts day and night, you know, people seeing me thanking them and all, you know how that goes, kind of back and forth a little bit. But it's worth it to have the prayer power behind you when you're kind of on a low limb, so to speak. You just, and I appreciate y'all praying for me on my recovery, and that's a real blessing. I think everything is right on schedule as far as that goes. And this with what they told us and how it was going to be, and not really any surprises to this point. And so we thank the Lord for that. And the last couple of days, well, since Sunday, I've just kind of laid low and walked a little bit, you know, around the house, and then drinking lots of fluids and doing all the things that they told me to do. So anyway, we've gotten a couple bulletin letters done, and we're going to try to slip over here maybe tomorrow or Friday and do some radio programs. So just pray for us. I was trying to kind of save strength for tonight. And again, I know we've got other preachers. Pray for the Brother Chris and Miss Tanya. They weren't able to make it tonight. Storming really bad in Camden, okay? And so you pray for them, okay? All right. Pray for the people in Turkey and Syria where they had the big earthquakes. I think I saw where it's over 7,000 or something like that, but it's probably a lot more than that underneath all the rubble. But, you know, I was watching, you know, little boys. There was a little baby that was born, his mama died, the little baby, the umbilical cord was still attached to the mama, and the baby lived, and the mama didn't. But I watched him rescue little boys and girls, and I was just thinking about hell. I started thinking about hell, and you know, I mean, an earthquake is really bad, and lots of people died in that earthquake. But as they were rescuing and digging through the rubble and finding people, you know, in pockets, you know, where people were, you know, some family members were gone and other family members were alive. And I was just thinking about, I just got to thinking about hell, and I just don't want people to go to hell. Like, man, I don't want them to go to hell and suffer forever. And I just, you know, it kind of just gave me a burden just watching. I was thinking that, you know, that's what we're doing when we tell people about Jesus. We're rescuing them. We're rescuing them from hell. And that's, it's so important, you know. And sometimes, you know, things like that, you know, kind of just remind us, you know, just like when you're hurting and then you know of others that are hurting and they're reaching out to you for prayer, you really, it's a serious thing to pray for them. Well, it's a serious thing that we'd be about our Father's business and trying to witness to people and try to reach them for the Lord Jesus Christ. Does somebody else have a prayer request that you'd like to like to add tonight? Pray for Brother Josh. He's flying out tomorrow, or flying out Friday, heading out tomorrow, and going up to New Jersey, and you pray for him as he travels, that God would give him traveling mercies. That would be a blessing. All right. Galen, your mom, okay. I want to pray for Miss Billy, and I want to pray for the expectant mothers in our church, that God would be with them and bless them and all of that. Had a blessing this week, and while I was sick, little David Keeler was praying for me, and he was pretty diligent every time he would pray to pray for Brother J.D. He's sick, and was even a little bit confused as to why I was at church before I went for my surgery, you know, because, you know, he thought, you know, I was sick, and so, you know, just he's just a little boy trying to process all of that. Well, little David got sick, and he had been praying for me, and Brother Andy said, Brother J.D., David's been praying for you, and he's sick now, and he asked if, said, Daddy, could you get Brother J.D. to pray for me? And so, you know, and I don't know, how old is David? Four. He's 4 years old, and so Miss Mandy and them keep David and all, and so I called, and I said, is David there? And they got David and said, David, it's Brother J.D. And so David got on the phone yesterday, and I said, David, I appreciate you praying for me. And he's like, yes, sir. And, you know, and then I said, well, your dad told me that you'd ask if I would pray for you. And so I prayed for him over the phone, and he was so excited and thankful, you know. Isn't that a blessing? I mean, that just blessed my heart that he would pray for me and then turn around and ask for me to pray for him. And I think it kind of says something about like that, like bear ye one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ, you know, and I think it says something about that, you know, pray without ceasing, and we ought to be praying one for another, shouldn't we? Sure should. And so anyway, thanks again for praying for me, and what a blessing. Anybody else have a prayer request, Miss Billy? Preston Scholler, okay, all right. All right. And I mentioned Sunday that was the one-year anniversary for Brother Travis and Miss Renee coming from Hampton. You know, the first Sunday they visited was Anniversary Sunday, and Preston had given them that gospel track at Walmart, you know, a year ago. Isn't that a blessing? And I know our labor's not in vain in the Lord, but I thank God for our young people getting out. Anybody have a testimony about anything tonight, passing out a track or anything tonight? Miss Raining, y'all didn't get to go? Okay. The rain came down and the floods came up, amen. And boy, we've been getting a lot of tracks out here lately ourselves. Miss Lydia? Okay, Brother Bob, pray for Brother Bob. He's down in his back. I talked to Brother Bob one day this week, and I said, how you doing on your weight? You know, and he'd been kind of up and down. You know, of course, it's hard to get through the holidays and all of that, but he had been at 308, and then he kind of eased back up a few pounds over the holidays, you know, and maybe 312 or 313, but this week he was down to 307, and so that's a blessing, isn't it? That's a big blessing, so I'm really proud of him, and I know it's kind of an ongoing thing, but still, it won't be long, he'll be under 300, so that'll be always a blessing, you know, and thank the Lord for that. So, you pray for him. I mean, we love Brother Bob around here. So, anybody else? Miss Debbie? Okay. Amen. Amanda Sanchez family, you pray for them. God would comfort their hearts. Okay, Miss Kathy. What was it? Jean Pretty. Okay. All right, Jean Pretty, on their hospice. Okay. All All right, Ms. Billy?
Karen Lively, she's a bachelor's rock owner, she's on hospice now.
Okay. Okay, all right, Karen Lively is in the hospice. All right, how many have an unspoken request, someone or some situation? Okay, God bless you. And praise the Lord. And I know you got me down there somewhere, so thank you for praying for me. All right, boy, what a great anniversary Sunday, amen. That was a blessing, and we just thank the Lord, amen. The Lord's so good, isn't he? And to God be the glory, great things he had done. So we just thank him for that, okay? All right, well, let's take a few moments here. We'll pray, give you a few minutes, and then we'll call on someone to close out our time of prayer tonight, okay? And again, you can look at your prayer sheet there, and there's lots of folks on there to pray for, okay? Let's come on, we'll do one more song, and I'll go ahead and let you pray for us, Brother Lee, if you would. That'd be good.
Father, we just come to you, and Lord, we're glad we can put our petitions in front of you, and you're ready to hear our prayers, Lord. And Lord, be with those who are hurting, and Lord, we pray that you just continue to be with Pastor, Lord, just continue to strengthen him, and Lord, and Miss Deanna, and just we pray that you'll be with Brother Bob, help him with his back, and be with Miss Peggy as she has her surgery on Monday. Just calm her nerves, and Lord, just continue to be with her, Lord. And Lord, we thank you for her, and Lord, we pray that for Mr. Titus, who has cancer, Lord, that you'll just pray that they'll remove it, and Lord, just continue to help him, and Lord, help his wife, be a blessing to him, and Lord, just meet with us tonight. We need to hear from you, and we ask this in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand. 488, a new name in glory.
I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not but God's angry frown. When the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to written, saved by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
All right, as ushers come, we'll pass out the offering envelopes. I believe like 2 weeks ago we asked for y'all to help us with backpack ministries at the Smackover School, and we've got a couple of people helping with that. And so what we're going to do, we're going to start also making some bags for some of our bus kids. It was a need that came up this past week, so we're going to just combine that and just make it our own backpack ministry. So if you have any questions, see Miss Stephanie or me, and we'll be glad to tell you what probably goes in the bag or what kind of, the idea is just small bag or small stuff like Vienna sausage or something they can microwave. Well, maybe small boxes of cereal. We don't like to do boxes of cereal because maybe they don't have milk. I can tell you a story about when I grew up, I had cereal with water. That was not good. But anyway, my kids said, we need milk. So, but hey, it is what it is. So just Pop-Tarts, something small. Just get them through the weekend so they can get back to school and have a good breakfast and good lunch. So anyway, so we'll pray. Father, we just thank you for this day, and Lord, bless this offering. We thank you for it. We thank you for our pastor again, Lord, and just give him strength. Preach to us, and Lord, let us have an open heart and listening ears to what you have for us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Lord, you left the splendor of heaven, the crown, a robe, and a throne. But what kind of love would lead you to leave the safety of that kind of home? I know that you willingly suffered, but why would you suffer for me? I know what I am, and I don't understand how I could be worth Calvary when you knew I was lost, and you knew that a cross was the price you'd have to pay. When we cried, crucify, Lord, you didn't have to die, but you did it anyway. Now I'll never see what you saw in me, 'cause you knew I would never be perfect. But I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it. Lord, sometimes I feel like a vessel, just useless old pieces of clay. But somehow you saw more, something worth dying for. You paid more than you should have paid. When you knew I was lost, and you knew that a cross was the price you'd have to pay. When we cried, crucify, Lord, you didn't have to die, but you did it anyway. I'll never see what you saw in me, 'cause you knew I would never be perfect. But I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it. And I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it.
All right. Thank you, Dalton. Appreciate that. Thank the Lord. I'm glad we was worth it. Amen. And if you have your Bibles tonight, turn to Colossians chapter 3.
Peyton's birthday.
It's Peyton's birthday. Okay. All right. All right, I forgot about that. Galen told me that. All right. Well, let's sing happy birthday, dear Peyton. Peyton, are you there? You okay? Make him stand up? No. Make him come up there? No. Anybody else have a birthday?
All right, happy birthday, dear Peyton. Yeah, we sang the Miana Sunday. Yeah. All right. Happy birthday, dear Peyton. Here we go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Peyton. Happy birthday to you. Good. Verse number two. Happy birthday to you. Only one will not do. Born again means salvation. How many have you? All right. Praise the Lord. Peyton has had that second birthday.
Colossians chapter number 1, if you have your Bibles there, I'm sorry, Colossians chapter 3. I may have said chapter 1, but I meant chapter 3, and that would be a blessing. And well, it was raining, it's slacking off now. It's preaching time. Colossians chapter 3, verse number 1. The Bible says, "If ye then being risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth, for ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. For which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in the which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them, but now ye also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. For there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision or uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on therefore as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, longsuffering, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness, however you want to say that, okay? Let's bow our heads. We'll pray. Father, bless the message now to our hearts, and we'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I've given you before, and we've kind of gone down through Colossians 3 and not too long ago and kind of expounded the verses and kind of, you know, gave you all the definitions on all the bad things there to put off and then some things to put on. And we gave you the ingredients of a Christian home, and we talked about that in verse number 15. And again, I have a preacher friend in Greenbrier, Arkansas, Brother Danny Allen, and he's a dear friend of mine. Brother Danny Allen's a tremendous Christian, I believe, and I also, he's a good preacher, great preacher, but he's also a prayer warrior, and I always call him, and he's on my short list of people to get to pray for me. When we were in the Philippines together years ago, Brother Justin Arenders, when Amber was over there, my niece, and we shared a room together, and it was a very humble little deal, and I got to sleep on the cot, you know, because I'm older and supersized and all that. And he slept on a little mat on the floor, and like a kindergarten mat. And I woke up in the morning early, like 4 o'clock in the morning, and Brother Danny Allen was like knelt down, like kind of like maybe you think a Chinese or somebody, you know, on his knees on the, you know, and he was praying like really, really early. And just I just really have a lot of respect for his prayer life, and he really walks with the Lord. But every year he's got me scheduled pretty much till Jesus comes back. Every year I go to his church, and he wants me to do a couple of nights on the home. He wants me to preach on the home, and just wanting to help his families. And so tonight I want to just kind of give you really quickly the little outline that I've given before, the ingredients of the Christian home, and then we're going to back up just a little bit and give you a little bit something else. So the ingredients of a Christian home, by the way, I'm really good, I would say, as humbly as I know how to say that, I know how to make a very good pan of Jiffy cornbread. I know how to set the oven at 400. I know how to put the two boxes of Jiffy cornbread mix into a mixing bowl. And I put two eggs in there, a third of a cup of milk for each box. And then I got a little whiskey thing, not whiskey, but a whisk, one of those things that you stir things up. Yeah, whisking it is one of my secret ingredients. Amen, Brother Josh got that. I see that hand back there. So I'm stirring it, and I know how to get all the lumps out of it, and then I put the pan, the skillet in the oven, and on 400, let the grease get hot, and I dump the cornbread mix in there. I set it on 19 minutes, and 19 minutes later, the little beeper goes off, and I take the cornbread out, and you can actually put a plate on top of it and turn it upside down, and man, it's all brown on the bottom, and it just looks, I mean, it looks amazing. And I know how to do that, and I'm really good at it. As humbly as I can, you know, I'm not trying to toot my own horn, but I mean, it's not, you know, like rocket science or anything, but you could do the same thing if you follow the instructions. But the problem is, if you leave out an ingredient like the eggs or the milk, it doesn't taste the same. Are you with me? Well, I'm going to substitute water for milk. It doesn't taste the same, Brother Lee, does it? Cereal doesn't taste the same. You know, I mean, just, you know, and trying to take a shortcut with the Lord and what God said, it doesn't work good, okay? So when we talk about the ingredients of a Christian home, I mean, I'm like all ears, okay? Because I want my home to be Christian. I want my home to be Christ-like. And I'm the daddy rabbit. I'm the head of my home. So, I mean, I want my home to be a Christian home. So let me just give you this little outline. Then we're going to back up just a little bit further and give you a little bit more, okay? Look down at verse number 16. Ingredient number one, it says, "And let the peace of God rule in your heart." So ingredient number one is peace, okay? And I've got that peace circled in my Bible. I've actually got the notes written out up here. Number one, peace. If you take notes, number one is peace, okay? And Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Let not the world, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." And man, I need the peace of God which passeth all understanding to keep my heart and mind, okay? And you know, it's a blessing when there's peace in your home. Somebody say amen right there. Man, when there's friction in the home and there's rebellion in the home and there's, it's hard on everybody. It's stressful. Somebody say amen right there. What would you say if we said peace? What would be the opposite of peace? War. Amen. Wow, when there's war and fighting going on in the home, it's just not good, is it? It's not. And so anyway, that's ingredient number one, the peace of God rule in your hearts. The which also you're called in one body, and be ye thankful. Ingredient number two is thankfulness. Ingredient number two is thankfulness. You know, the Bible says, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." So we want to be thankful, don't we, in everything, okay? No matter what the circumstances are, we just need to thank the Lord. Amen. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord, okay? Boy, Dalton, that was a good song, "Thank the Lord." Dalton, that was a terrible song, "Thank the Lord." Hey, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You know, sometimes we think we whatever, you know, like we got, no, we ain't got nothing. I mean, we need to be thanking God for everything. Because the Bible says, "In everything, give thanks." Okay? Are you with me? I was talking to David Debman the other day, and he was going to be preaching to a bunch of preachers in India via Zoom, like 54 preachers or something like that. And he'd never done that before. He'd never spoken with an interpreter, you know. And I said, "Brother David, it's going to be terrible." And he's like, "Really?" He said, "Man," I said, "it's going to be terrible. I'm telling you, it's going to be terrible." Because when you preach with an interpreter and you've never done it before, you're trying to listen to the interpreter, and it's like stopping and starting and stopping and starting, and just it doesn't feel like your message flows like it does when you're just speaking in your native tongue in English and there's no stops and starts. Are you with me? And so you're stopping, you're listening, you're hearing him subconsciously, but you got to have your next thought, and it just seems like it's a total flop. What does that mean? It's kind of a life lesson, really, that the preaching, the singing, Brother Bobby, it ain't about us. It ain't about me trying to wow somebody with a super-duper sermon. No, it's like I need God. Yeah, it'd all be a big mess. The recipe would flop. The cake wouldn't rise if it wasn't for the Lord. Are you with me? We need God. We need God to help us. I don't care if you're praying or whatever you're doing, singing in the choir. We need God to help us. We need God, and we ought to be so thankful when he does help us. Amen. I've been going back, and I've been saying, "Lord, I thank you 1,000 times over for helping me with my surgery. I thank you, I thank you, I thank you for helping me with my surgery." I've been telling him thank you over and over and over again because I want him to know that I mean it. Amen. And I'm very thankful, okay? So ingredient number two is thankfulness. And then it says, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly." Let the word of Christ. Ingredient number three in a Christian home, number one is peace. Number two is thankfulness. Number three is the word of God. The word of God. The word of God. The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. Yeah, amen. Thank God for the Bible. Amen.
and the Word of God. We want that ingredient. And then it says, the Word of Christ dwelling you richly in all wisdom. Wisdom. Wow, I need, the Bible says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. Let him ask of God. God, I need your wisdom. Are you with me? I need God's wisdom. You need God's wisdom. Boy, what a great ingredient. How many times have I thought I had something when I didn't have anything? And I made a big mess out of things because I didn't even ask God to give me wisdom. I just did it my way instead of his way. Wisdom. God's wisdom is pure and gentle and peaceable and without partiality and without hypocrisy. Man's wisdom is earthly and sensual and devilish. And I need God's wisdom. Please, God, please help me. Lord, I don't know what to do. I'm clueless. I need help. Number five, and it says, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And ingredient number five in a Christian home is Christ-honoring music. Christ-honoring music. You know, that's a really big thing. Christ-honoring music. You know, there's some music that honors Christ, and then there's other music that it doesn't have anything to do with Christ. You know, there's a lot of rap music and rock music, and boy, if you listen to the words, if you listen to the lyrics of the song, it's terrible, it's vile and wicked. You know what I'm saying? And wow, I'm telling you, it's kind of, some of that stuff is really scary. It's demonic. Are you listening to me today? It does everything but glorify the Lord. Are y'all don't know what I'm talking about? I mean, man, I don't want that kind of music in anywhere around me. I don't like, you know, I mean, I don't even like it when it pulls up next to me at the red light. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'll turn up my Christian music, you know, and if you know what I'm saying. I mean, I like Christ-honoring music. And by the way, it hasn't always been that way with me. It hasn't always been that way with Miss Deanna. We used to like country music, and we used to like rock music back when we were younger, and we were wrong. Young people, we were wrong. We were dead wrong. And we still know all those songs. Miss Deanna knows more of them than I do. I mean, I'm just, wow, she just, I mean, it's unbelievable how many bad songs she can remember. But pray for her, amen? And I'm not calling her out. I'm not. I wouldn't do that for $1 million, but she sure knows a lot of them. Don't you, honey? No, I tell you, we all know, you know, and you walk through the mall. We used to walk through the mall, and we don't do that anymore too much, you know. It costs a lot of money to walk through malls for me these days, so I try to stay away from them. I'm not preaching against them, but anyway, I don't go there often, I can tell you that, amen. And then number six is accountability to Christ. Accountability to Christ. Now, look at verse number 17. It says, and whatsoever you do. It's almost like the Lord said, in case I forgot something, you know, I want you to have peace in your home. I want you to have thankfulness in your home. I want you to have the Word of God in your home. I want you to have wisdom in your home. I want you to have Christ-honoring music in your home. But then accountability to Christ is like, and whatsoever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. Now, that's a good little outline. That's a good little recipe right there. Six things. Now, I want you to back up to verse number 12, and I want to give you seven more ingredients of a Christian home. Seven more things that are given in a list in verse number 12. You know, in verse number 8, it says, but now you also put off all these, and it gives you a list of things to put off, anger, wrath, malice, and so forth. Well, in verse number 12, it says, put on therefore. I'm glad God says, put this off, put this on. I can understand that. Put this off, put the bad off, put the good on, okay? Put on therefore as the elect of God. Now it says here, holy, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy. Number one is bowels of mercy. What is bowels of mercies? What in the world is bowels of mercies? Bowels of mercy is kind of, it's like having a sympathizing spirit. You know, in my heart, when Brother Lee says and Miss Stephanie says, we got little kids that are hungry, would you help put a little food bag together for one of the little kids that that's coming to be Sunday school hungry, or, you know, one of the little kids that we have knowledge of that they don't have food on the weekend. You know, would you help us? You know, well in my heart, are you letting down inside of me there's something that says, hey, that's a good thing. We need to help those little boys and girls. But down inside of you, that's bowels of mercy. And God puts that in your heart. When you're a child of God, God puts that in your heart to want to help people that need help like that. Man, by nature, you know, we're selfish and we're stingy. And there's a lot of people in the world that don't care. There's a lot of selfish and stingy, and it's all about them. And they don't give a rip about little kids or anybody else. Man, that's not that kind of spirit. You know what I'm saying? We want to have bowels of mercy. We want, I mean, the missionary stories. And when I was seeing them pulling little boys and girls out of the rubble in Turkey and Syria, out of those buildings, you know, little babies covered in dust and something inside of me, I was sitting there and I was crying. I was thinking about hell and people dying and going to hell. But I'm glad they're rescuing those, by the way. I was really glad the ones that got help and got rescued. What is that? Bowels of mercy. Do you care? Do you care? I do. I want to have that spirit in my heart and in my home to care for people that are less fortunate. Number two, right after bowels of mercy, the next one is kindness. 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 I'm talking about the ingredients of a Christian home. Bowels of mercy, a sympathizing spirit. Number two, kindness. Kindness is just inward, tender, unfeigned, where there's no pretense. You're not just, you know, acting one way, but you really don't care on the inside. But it's inward, tender, unfeigned, and abundant mercy. Just being kind. Be kind one to another. Tender-hearted. Man, what a blessing. Man, we ought to be so kind to each other. I always love that Bible illustration about Mephibosheth. You've heard me say it before. That little crippled boy down there in Lodabar. And they inquired, King David did, if there was any left of the house of Saul, and they found that little cripple boy. And David said, hey, you can eat at my table. You can eat at my table. What was that? That was the kindness. That was the kindness of the king. That was bowels of compassion of King David loving a little cripple boy named Mephibosheth. And you know what? Really, that's what Jesus did for us. We're the Mephibosheth in the story, amen, and God showed his kindness to you and I. Isn't that a blessing? Man, he's sure been kind to me. I know he could have thumped me off into hell. Well, hey, I want to be kind to others. Number three is humbleness of mind. Humbleness of mind. Esteeming others better than yourself. Esteeming others better than yourself. I can remember my dad telling stories, which my Aunt Jody was telling a story a while ago about my Grandma Wido whipping the girls, you know, and she'd get them and whip them, and she said she could really whip and hard and made Aunt Jody not want to do whatever she was doing that was bad. She didn't have to get too many whippings because it hurt, and she didn't like that. She was learning. But I remember my dad telling stories about my grandma, how they'd pass the chicken bowl. Maybe they had fried chicken. How Grandma Wido would let everybody else get their piece first. And then she'd wait till all the kids, you know, had their piece and Papa got his piece and she would, whatever's left over, you know. And people are pretty good at picking pieces of chicken. How many of you are pretty good at picking a piece of chicken? Yeah, God bless you. I see those hands. Oh, yeah. Miss Deanna, she likes thighs. I like chicken breast. I like chicken wings, too. But, you know, I mean, my dad would tell, like, Grandma would maybe get the neck. Ain't a whole lot of meat on a chicken neck. But, you know, when you got a whole bunch of kids and one chicken bowl and you're a mama, and you love your kids, you want them to be fed before you're fed. You want to take care of, what is that? That's humbleness of mind. No, you go ahead and take it. That's humbleness of mind when you want it, but you let somebody else have your place or your piece. It's good, isn't it? Yeah. Boy, we need that in our home, don't we? Yeah. Man, our homes can get out of order. Our homes can be missing some ingredients. I'm talking about a Christian home, the ingredients of a Christian home. Number four is meekness. Meekness is quietly submitting to the will of God. Quietly submitting to the will of God. You know, when Jesus said in the Garden of Gethsemane, he prayed, but he said, not my will, not my will. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou, he just yielded his will. What was that? That's meekness. By the way, Moses was said about Moses, he was the meekest man in all the world during his time. And Moses, one of the greatest Bible leaders, one of the greatest characters in the Bible. I mean, he led the children of Israel. Moses was a great man of God and great leader, but he was a meek man. So meekness is not weakness. Are you listening to me? I'm just saying it's quietly submitting to the will of God. Number five, long-suffering. Long-suffering. We're just looking at that list. And kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. Long-suffering is it patiently bears the evil words and the evil actions of others. Man, people are ugly, aren't they? A lot of times people can be in the world, they can be really ugly and say hurtful things. And we got to be long-suffering. My Aunt Jody got a haircut, and the lady, the beautician or whatever, they cut her hair really short. She doesn't like it. And my Aunt Jody said, I wanted to slap her. I mean, when they show you the mirror and you look at your, after they're kind of done, check it out. My Aunt Jody's like, where's all my hair at, I asked her, I said, was the lady Indian? I thought she might have scalped her. And she said, well, I think she might have been half. She might have been half Indian. And boy, she was fired up, But that's, long-suffering is not slapping somebody. Well, maybe it was long-suffering. She didn't slap them anyway. Praise the Lord for that. She might have wanted to, but she didn't. Amen. Lord have mercy. Hey, listen, we got to be long-suffering on the home front, don't we? Sometimes you want to wring the kids' necks. And you just got to be long-suffering. Kids, sometimes you got to be long-suffering with your parents and all that. It goes both ways, doesn't it? Long-suffering. Number six, forbearing one another. Look at that, verse number 13, forbearing one another. What's that? Exercising patience. Exercising patience with one another. And I haven't always been that way, and you haven't either. And I need to work on that one, forbearing one another. Just kind of, putting up with each other. And then it says forgiving one another. And forgiving one another means you just pardon them, you let them go, you forgive. And what a blessing to forgive one another. And so bowels of mercy, number one, just a sympathizing spirit. Number two, kindness, an inward tenderness, unfeigned and abundant mercy. Number three, humbleness of mind, esteeming others better than themselves. Meekness, quietly submitting to the will of God. Number four, long-suffering patiently bears the evil words and actions of others. And then number six, forbearing one another, exercising patience. And then number seven, forgiving one another, pardoning, letting it go, and letting the offender off the hook. And then God covers these seven things with the overcoat of love. And look at verse number 14, and we'll be done. And above all these things are all important. These seven things right there are important. But above all these things, put on charity. Put on charity. What does charity mean? It's love, isn't it? Put on charity. Love. Put on love. Put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness or perfectness or however you want to say that word. The Bible says this, and I'm done, but the Bible says this, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples if ye have love one to another. And I want to tell you something, it's important that we love one another, especially in our homes. You ever struggle with some of these things? I remember when I was a teenager, and I'm done, I'm closing, but I remember when I was a teenager, we went on a field trip with our Christian school to downtown Fort Worth, and they had the botanical gardens, and they had some things downtown Fort Worth. Of course, the stockyards are there, and we took our school down there, and we're walking in downtown Fort Worth. And, you know, there's like street people, homeless people. You know, there's bars and all kinds of that kind of stuff when you get down in the inner cities of big towns like that. And so anyway, we're downtown Fort Worth, and, you know, we're all lined up, and we've got our ACE uniforms on and all of that. And I was really struggling. As a teenager, I was struggling probably maybe more with myself than anybody else. But I'd gotten in some trouble at school, and I don't know why. The man was a good man, but I was struggling with Brother Niffen, Brother Wally Niffen, and he was there at our school. And I'm thinking he was the principal. I think it was either him or Brother Art, but I think it was Brother Niffen. Yeah, it was Brother Niffen. And anyway, you know, he wasn't very tall, and, you know, I'm a big old teenage boy. I'm probably a lot taller than Brother Niffen, and him and his wife both were kind of shorter. And well, anyway, we're walking along there, and man, this drunk comes out of this bar, and, you know, and Brother Niffen's there, you know, and he's kind of, you know, we're all lined up, you know, a bunch of little bunch of little Christian school kids. We weren't all sweet. I wasn't sweet, I know that. But, you know, and this drunk, you know, he's kind of, well, Brother Niffen sees this guy, you know, and he starts, you know, like kind of trying to run interference for the kids in the school, you know, to keep this guy away from the kids in the school, which that's what you do, you know. I mean, we're here to protect our kids. And this guy comes out, and he's drunk, and he's belligerent, and he's being ugly. And, well, Brother Niffen kind of steps in, and, you know, he's trying to, you know, and this guy starts getting, like, really mad at Brother Niffen. And even though I had some stuff in my heart toward Brother Niffen, when that drunk started messing with my principal, man, I wanted to help Brother Niffen. And what it just revealed that I really didn't have a problem with Brother Niffen. I really loved Brother Niffen. You know, it was really my problem. It wasn't Brother Niffen's problem. It was my problem. I was just struggling myself. Are you listening to me? And I'm just saying tonight that most of the time, all the time, when there's a problem, it's sure not on that end. If there's a problem, it's on my end. I've left something out of the recipe. I've left a real important ingredient out, you know, like kindness or bowels of mercy or something like, you know what I'm saying, something that really does matter. And I've left it out. And I just think it'd be a good time to get down on, you know, our knees tonight and say, you know, God, I don't know what's wrong with me, but I haven't had peace in my heart. It's just I've been struggling within myself, and Lord, I need it. I need 2/3 a cup of peace tonight. Lord, I need a cup of thanksgiving tonight. Lord, my life's a flop right now. It's not your fault, Lord. It's my fault because I've left some things out. I'm half baked. I'm half-baked, Lord. I know I'm half-baked, and I need help. You came to the right place tonight. God wants to help you. Let's bow our heads tonight. Thank you for listening. Miss Crystal, play something softly tonight. Man, I'm glad I'm saved. I'm glad that because I'm saved, I can put off the old things that would have destroyed my life and sent me to hell, and I can get some peace and some thanksgiving and some the Word of God and wisdom and Christ-honoring music. Wow, I can get all these good ingredients in my life. I can have bowels of mercy and kindness and humbleness of mind and meekness and long-suffering and, wow, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. And then I can cover it all in love tonight. We love Him because He first loved us. Father, bless the message now. Speak to our hearts. Lord, help us to make some adjustments tonight. It might be one thing. It might be two things. It may be a whole list of things, Lord, that we've been kind of falling short on, left out of the recipe. Lord, help us tonight, Lord, to have a Christian home. We'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together. Ms. Crystal, play softly. You need to come to the altar tonight. Ask God to help you. He sure is a good God. You know somebody who's really having a hard time in their home, man. You might want to pray for them. kind of like taking a backpack, you know. We're going to take backpacks to these little kids that are hungry. Well, there's a lot of homes that are hurting tonight. A lot of homes need some help tonight. Maybe God would equip you to say, hey, Pastor gave us a whole recipe here for a Christian home tonight. Let me give this to you. It's a good little outline. It's right there in Colossians chapter number 3. And, wow, wouldn't you like to have a Christian home? And, boy, I'll tell you, maybe God would use you to help be a blessing to somebody else. That'd be awesome, wouldn't it? Just like God used little Preston to give a tract to the Stith family. I know Brother Travis and Miss Renee are so thankful that God used Preston. They love Preston. I love Preston. We all love Preston, but they're glad that Preston had enough courage to give them that gospel tract. And they're so glad that God led them to our church, and we're glad that God led them to our church. We're so thankful, and they're a blessing. And they're praying for us, and we thank the Lord for that. But wow, wouldn't it be good to be used by God to help somebody in their home? Boy, a lot of homes need help today, I'm telling you. Wow. A lot of homes. I'm going to a church in November, Southside Baptist Church in Weatherford, Texas. The pastor's name is Pastor Merrill, and I've got some people that are going to come to hear me preach when I preach there. A bricklayer, two brothers, Jimmy and Johnny, that grew up with my wife's grandparents, raised them, and they're going to come and hear me preach when I get there. And there's the Stewart, it's Larry and Sylvia Stewart, their daughter Kelly lives in Weatherford, and they're getting her the information to come and hear me preach there. And Brother Merrill says, I want you to preach Sunday school, Sunday morning, and Sunday night on the home. I mean, man, churches are hurting, homes are hurting, people need help. People need help, I need help. You need help. But God sometimes wants to use us, equip us to help somebody else with their home. I'd rather get my help from right here than anywhere else. Amen. And it's the best recipe book in the world. Amen. Well, thank you all for being here tonight. And Brother Richard, why don't you come up and dismiss us tonight? And man, I'm glad I'm saved. Keep praying for me. And we appreciate that very much. Pray for Miss Deanna. And that God continue to watch over her. She really, just her back and neck and all that. I know it was all the traveling, and, you know, she didn't complain. You know, we laid some ground rules and no complaining, and so she didn't complain. But it's been real hard and hurt her a lot. You know, she's been hurting a lot since we got back. And, you know, she really kind of was right there with me and for me and all that during all my time. But anyway, Brother Charles Best, and then they got her one of those TENS units, and so going to help her, you know, like to be able to get, you know, some shocking going on to help her muscles release. She got muscle spasms and all kinds of chronic back and neck pain. So keep her in your prayers too, okay? Because it takes those trips like that where you travel that far, that fast. I mean, takes a few days to get over it. And I've been able to rest up, but she's been over here working in school, and she maybe hadn't got to rest like I've gotten to rest. So I know she's tired and all that, but pray for her too. Would you do that for me? Would you pray for Miss Deanna? And I know everybody has been, and we certainly appreciate that very much, okay? And we love y'all. And listen, Sunday, don't miss Sunday. I mean, everybody needs to bring like 10 visitors. Listen, Sunday, I'm going to preach Sunday on the snake bite of discouragement. I'm going to tell you some snake stories about Josh Mullinax, the snake handling Baptist preacher. And it's going to be good, y'all. You're going to love it, okay? So do not miss. For all of you listening around the world, we're joking. We're not snake handling Baptists. But anyway, I had to kind of clear that up, Brother Josh. Amen. That was a joke, okay? We've got millions of people listening around the world, and we don't want them to fall in that category. Amen. Brother Jimmy's moving away from Brother Josh right now. I don't blame you, Brother Jimmy. Amen. He's probably got one in his pocket. Amen. All right. Well, anyway, do not miss Sunday. It's going to be good. It's going to be a two-parter at least, Sunday morning, Sunday night. And it's going to be a blessing, okay? And that was good last week on discouragement, wasn't it? And a lot of people get discouraged and all that. Great, tremendous truths from the Bible. Amen. So don't miss this week, okay? And that'll be, what did I say? It may be depression. Anyway, one's depression, one's discouragement. Anyway, it's going to be good. Don't miss it. Come on, Brother Richard.
All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank for today, and I thank for all the love and care you've given us. And thank you, Lord, for this night with the service and the message, and with just reminding us about all the important ingredients of home. And pray, Lord, just be with those that are struggling and are are hurting, Lord, and especially those overseas with the earthquakes, and just give them love and care in that regard. And pray that you just be with everyone else tonight. Safe travels home despite the storms, and just keep it all safe. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.